All right, here we are back at the 20-sided store in Brooklyn, New York, for the third round of play in the Android Netrunner tournament that took place on April 6th, 2014. This is round three of four. I come into this round getting a two-win sweep in round one and splitting round two with corp wins. So I've got one runner loss, which you saw in the other video, where I got hit with the crazy score three-pointer immediately combo. So here I am against your favorite opponent with your favorite playmat, Chris. He's playing Jinteki, as usual. And we basically already have seen this video before, right? How to beat Jinteki with the Deus X. You know, some people still don't believe this, that like this is, you know, Jinteki, they're still afraid of Jinteki, or who knows, but you know, I guess this happened at a tournament. I took a video of it, and there are some interesting things that happen in this game to differentiate it from previous games you've seen with pretty much the exact same decks and strategies. So let's watch this game, see what happens. You know, I'm pretty much looking for the first turn Deus Ex. I think I have SMC, which is good enough. Do I? I don't know. Oh, I have Kati Jones? I don't know what I have. I can't see. I'm shuffling my cards too fast. Okay. What's Jinteki going to do? Taking some money, protecting the R&D. Okay, I guess he's afraid of that first turn indexing. I'm gonna dirty laundry HQ with my data sucker, first click, right? If there's a second click, if there's a snare, I'll be fine. It's not the end of the world. Let's pick a card, how about that one? It's a Jackson Howard, get that out of my face. Get that out of here. I still end up with 5 credits. I spent 2 for the Dirty Laundry, 3 for the Jackson. At the end of the run, after the run was over, I gained 5 from the Dirty Laundry. Got my data sucker, drew some cards. Here we go. Install Advance Advance. What a ballsy Jinteki. Just install Advance Advance like that. And I don't have a Deus Ex or anything. I got an SMC though. But if I'm going to use the whole SMC to get Deus Ex right now. So I drew Install. Install clone chip. Install daily cast, right? See, I was basically afraid there, right, of even if I got my Deus Ex, right, with the SMC and ran. If that was a cerebral overrider, there was a chance, a good chance, I would lose the clone chip. And the clone chip is basically a whole Deus Ex. So, and there he goes, scoring a Nisei. So he's got his Nisei, great. Yeah, I think some of his R&D cards get turned around backwards, whatever, so he's trying to sort them out. It's annoying. You want all your cards facing the same way. They don't have an advantage like normal playing cards that go in either direction, no problem, right? Especially when the sleeves are open on one end and not on the other. That makes it even worse. You really just want to have them all facing the same way. So he scores a Nisei because I can't afford to lose a clone ship and run it that turn. But it's only 2 points. I just, you know, as long as I don't let him get 5 more, it'll be okay. It'll be okay. I'll get hit by all the cerebral overriders you want once I've got crappy, useless cards in my hand. So on his turn, I'm going to get my Deus Ex. There it is. Jinteki killer. Daily casts. Because my turn is now starting. I did that on his turn. Shuffling up good after my self-modifying code play. doesn't have any remotes right now. HQ is unprotected. I've got a handful of cards. Dropping a second data sucker. Okay. And run an HQ just to get more. See, so I saved two credits there. One in the Deus X install on his turn, and one in the data sucker on my turn. Oh, I can't trash that Jackson. I really wish I could have. I didn't have three credits. I only had two because I'm expecting Fetal, right? So I pay for the Fetal. But I guess nowadays I shouldn't run without four, because NAPD is a thing, right? I don't know if you play an NAPD in a Jinteki. Maybe you would. Maybe you would. But they wouldn't take any damage if they saw an NAPD and couldn't score it. So... yeah, all right. Clone chips, more daily casts. This is basically a clone chip is the one card that I can't allow to be destroyed, because a clone chip equals a Deus Ex. I basically have three Deus Ex on the table, and I can still like test run it, run. If it's in the trash, I could test run Deus Ex, run, and if I don't use it, it'll go to the top of my deck where I can draw it and install it. See, now I have Deus Ex. I run without fear. When something's only too advanced, good thing, it was a Ronin, so I trash it. One click left, I'm going to make a zero Atman, right? Why did I make a zero Atman? Because I have a lot of data sucker tokens. I'm going to have a lot with two, because I have two data suckers. And that way I'm not afraid of any Jinteki stuff, right? I've got three data suckers, so I can break a katana, at least. I know he's got Yagura out there. I didn't know he had Hive. Oof, that Hive only has three subroutines, but oh boy. I'm going to let that on the run. Oh, and he res Caprice, which he has to res at the same time he reses Hive in order for it to have an effect. That's the last window available to him to res that. So, we're just, I think we're going to let that end the run right now. And now the ultimate anti-Hive weaponry on click two. No, draw. Grimoire. Parasite. Oh, right. I wanted to install the Parasite, but I did not have the memory for it, which is why I didn't just install it right away. And I said, oh, I need Grimoire. That's the only card in my deck that has memory. And so I drew a card, and sure enough, it was Grimoire. That's the epitome of luck. It's a card game, people. That happens. I'm like, dang, I want to do this, but I don't have the memory for it. And I was thinking about throwing away a data sucker, but I just drew a card, and Grimoire was right there. Okay, so he throws away his Hive because it's going down anyway. In the dirty laundry of the archives. Whoa, there's an NEPD in there. I can't take it, though. But now I have seven credits because I just... so now I run the archives and take it. Yep, and I take a net damage. That's fine. That's pretty clever, right? Is, you know, people are going to be afraid because of shock. People are afraid to run archives against Jinteki. Especially this face-down cards. So put NEPD and Fetal in the archives. And maybe they can't afford to score them all, even if they run there. And then they'll take all... if they can't afford to score enough of them to win, they'll just take all that Fetal damage and, you know, and shock damage. They might just die. It's basically making archives into a death trap. If a runner without a pile of money and a fistful of cards decides to run it. Oh, so here we're discussing a rule before I try anything, right? We're discussing a rule that I wasn't sure of, which is there a timing window, right? If I run, break the ice, and then we play the Caprice game, and I win the Caprice game, after I win that game, is there a chance for him to use the Nisei token? And the answer is yes, because the Caprice game happens after I pass the last piece of ice. So I pass the last piece of ice. Then we played the Caprice game. All right, run that remote. There's a Jackson. He uses it. He takes back all three of his cards. I passed the last piece of ice. We played the Caprice game. I win. Now it's, we've moved forward to what usually happens when you pass the last piece of ice, which is, are you going to access? I say yes. Then he has a chance to res cards and use paid abilities, one of which would be Nisei. So even if you win the Caprice game, use a Nisei token. Well, you're going to have to win the Caprice game again. If he chooses to do that. So I've been a little poor. So I got this Kati Jones rocking. Pretty much have a full loadout here. There's a Parasite in the trash. There's two clone ships, which I kind of only want to use in Deus X. There's a Deus X. There's a Zero Atman. And there's a mountain of Datasucker tokens. There's an open archives. It doesn't even have any cards in it. R&D has an annoying Caprice. There's a Nisei token, both of which are sort of blocking any indexing attempts. HQ not defended so much. And remote is beginning to be defended. Daily cast, fill Katie. So I'm just gonna spend a turn loading up because there's nothing really forcing me to do anything else. Take two and install. Empty Katie. Daily cast. 0 to 8. Did I draw a card with that other click? I think I might have. Gonna run that remote. Let's see what he's got going on. Oh, it's a melange. He didn't res, and there was a melange there. I trashed that. Goodbye. Oof. I cannot allow that. I have another click, I think. I take a credit because I'm not allowed to fill Katie because I just emptied Katie. Install advanced twice. I've just shown my hand that I'm gonna run if he installs something. And he installs something. I'm smelling a Cerebral Overrider. Smells like one to me. Smells like a Cerebral Overrider. Daily cast. All right, I'm gonna run R&D instead. I've got an indexing in my hand. Another hive. Wow. Wow. I want to save my clone ship for a Deus Ex. So I'll end the run. I'll just install the Parasite onto the hive from my hand. It gets one from Grimoire. I run. I use two Datasuckers. I don't get them back yet because we're about to play the Caprice Psy game. Psy game! Psy game. I turn two of my credits into two ones. I put some number of them in my fist. So I actually right now have six, seven, I have nine credits. I don't have seven. Right? I have nine. And any I don't spend, I still have. We both spend zero. I win! He's not using his Nisei token. I trash Caprice Nisei for one credit. And I access Cerebral Overrider, trash that. And now I get the two Datasuckers back that I used. And I have a click left. Normally, I would just run R&D again, but what if that's a snare? Sure, I'd avoid it with Deus Ex, but I would still get tagged. And Kati Jones would be dead. So, who knows if he has a closed account, or who knows what he's got. Okay, first click indexing. He made a mistake here. He should have used his Nisei token to block that indexing. And he did not. He immediately afterwards, he's like, oh, I'm dumb. I should have, yeah. Agendas are the worst. Because they sit over on the side of the table. You don't see them. And you sort of forget about them, right? So I'll just lose all my cards. I don't care. And now I'm at 6. Yep. Got one click left. I'll draw a card. Okay. Yeah, if he would have just used his Nisei to block that indexing, I might not be at 6 points right now. Uh-oh. Install advance twice, another card. Now, normally, I'm trying to keep him from getting anything advanced above 2. Because anything advanced above 2 suddenly is like, you can get this double Ronin threat. Or he's already making it look like a double Ronin over there, right? Which is super scary. See? But I've got 6 points, and he's only got 2. So I'm really, really not... and I have a Deus Ex and 2 clone chips, so I don't have to run. Normally, I have to run and third clone chip. It's even better. So normally, I have to run and clear out all his remotes. I can't let him set up anything nasty. But in this case, when I'm at 6 and he's at 2, I can let him, do some stuff, and just look for my final point elsewhere. Oh, this is looking scary. Setting up a double Ronin there. He could be like, shipment from Kaguya, Ronin. It could happen. Ice isn't really going to hold me out with, because I'll Parasite a Swordsman and I'll Atman anything else with a million Datasucker tokens. So really, I'm just looking for another indexing, right? I'm asking him, is there a cerebral in the trash? Yes, there is. What are the odds that there's more on the table? All right, I'm going to run the server that's advanced. He's not rezzing. I'll access. It's a June bug. Cancel that with my Deus Ex. Trash it. Immediately... clone ship my Deus Ex back into play. And take some credit. Okay. Okay, so at worst, it's a single Ronin. Not in so much danger anymore. Install same old thing. Use it to play indexing. Again, he didn't use the Nisei token. Yeah, I'm looking at archives while I'm looking at the index to figure out how I want to arrange it. I guess there isn't a game winner in there. Run R&D. And trash this Ronin, see? So now, I think Yeah, oh, that's right, because he brought a Ronin back with a Jackson earlier in the game. That's why I was looking at archives to see how many Ronins there were, right? Because if I see a Ronin indexing and I know a Ronin's in the trash, then that means there's only one Ronin left. But I guess double Ronin is a threat still. But not right now, because only one thing on the table. Another same old thing installed, drawn some cards, and it's on another same old thing. Just have to wait for him to draw through that index there. Oh, that's right. This is what happened here. This is interesting, and there are misplays on both sides of the table. So I think when I indexed, there was a Jackson Howard. And I need to trash that Jackson Howard. Because if there's a Jackson Howard on the table, then he can prevent my indexing, right? Which is how I'm going to win. So, I'm just going to run R&D. I'll break that Yagura with my Atman. I'll break both subroutines. And then I'm like, this is the Jackson Howard, right? Oh no, it's the Zaibatsu loyalty. oops. I messed up my index. I totally forgot the order I put the cards in. I really wanted to trash that Jackson Howard, so he couldn't block my indexing. I see I already have the same old thing on the table. But I guess I misindexed. So that's a huge misplay. I could have trashed that Jackson Howard and indexed freely. But I didn't. Okay, so he's got an unadvanced card there. See, so now I'm gonna run R&D again, I think, even though it's a right. It's like, did I put that? Because I messed up. I'm like, oh shit, where is that Jackson Howard? Is it there? Nope, it's not there either. I messed up the index. So now I basically assume he's got it in his hand or he already installed it. So is it that card behind the ice or is it that other unadvanced card? So I run the thing that's iced up. I access. Oh, it's a snare. Crap. Oh, I'll Deus X that. Take the tag. And remove the tag. And then once his turn starts, I'm going to get my Deus Ex back in case that's a Ronin. Yes. Yep. As soon as my turn starts, get Deus Ex back on the table. In case that thing that's been advanced is a Ronin. Okay, so now at this point, I should be thinking that card he just installed is Jackson Howard. And the one at the end of the table, I'm imagining, is the Zaibatsu loyalty that I saw when I ran R&D on the miss index. So I'm gonna same old thing index, right? Why do I have same old thing indexing? Because I didn't, right? Because I ran the card I thought was Jackson Howard, it was Snare. Right? I didn't realize he replaced it with the other card, even though you just saw that he did. Okay? I'm imagining the card at the end of the table is Zaibatsu Loyalty. So for some reason, even though I was thinking about Jackson Howard, suddenly I forgot about it and I thought that it wasn't on the table. It's in his hand. He misplayed, and he knows he misplayed, not installing it to block my index. But there I did same old thing indexing, and he Nisei'd. So, right? That ended up not mattering. But now I have an indexing in my hand, so I play it. There's a Tsurugi. I'm going to use my last clone chip to parasite that out of the way, because I'm pretty sure this index is a winning play. So misplays on both sides here. I should have realized that one of those cards in the table was the Jackson Howard that I misindexed. He should have actually installed one of those cards, should have been the Jackson Howard that I misindexed. Right? That he had in his hand. But he didn't install it for whatever reason. He installed some other cards in those servers. So when I run again here and get the Gila hands for the win, right? He's on, you know, he could have blocked that if the Jackson Howard had been installed. You know, so we discussed that whole situation. Very strange, right? Where both players mess up, right? And in this case, it turns out in the runner's favor. But yeah, you know, it was. I thought that was Jackson. I ran it. It was Snare. I thought the other one was Zaibatsu. The middle one was, you know, who knows what it was. So I didn't see that he replaced the Snare with something else. If I had seen that and paid closer attention, I would have thought that that was the Jackson and run it. I still would have thought the other one was Zaibatsu. Just for some reason, that's what my feelings told me. You know, but he didn't put down the Jackson, so that it should have been the Jackson, but it wasn't. If it was, my indexing would have failed. So it would have failed. One indexing would fail to Nisei Token, and one indexing would fail to Jackson Howard. Unless I trash Jackson Howard first and then index, which is what I should have done, is run the right. So, you know, and maybe that's why he didn't install the Jackson Howard, right? Is like, you know, just install another snare or a shock or something, and then, you know, I have to basically believe that that's Jackson Howard, right? So I'm gonna run it, right? He's like, if I install, you know, he knows that I misindexed and was looking for the Jackson, so if he installs a face down card that's unadvanced, I'm supposed to think it's Jackson. He was basically playing, you know, to match my correct play. But I misplayed, and the misplay turned out to be the correct play against the misplay, and whatever. I'm sure you understand the situation by now. So, here we go. I've talked about this deck on the internet before, but I don't think there's too many videos of it out there. This, I think, is actually the first good video of this runner deck playing as it's meant to play. So this is the kit deck. It's way dangerous. Way dangerous. I don't think it lost any games this day, if I'm not mistaken. It's so good. And NBN is, as we know, is so good. So let's see what happens when you have these two so good decks matching up. This should be a more exciting game, right? The my Kate versus Jinteki is a really bad matchup for him. I've got all the anti Jinteki weaponry, but here in this case, you know, NBN has the anti everyone weaponry, but so does Kit, and my deck has mad code gates. Mad code gates. I think I have more code gates than, not sentries and barriers combined, but I have more code gates than sentries and more code gates than barriers. You know, I guess the three pop-up windows really is what puts it over the top, right? It's three pop-up window, one toll booth, two quandary, two RSVP. So if you take out if you include the three toll booths, that's one, two, three, four. It's five code gates with the pop-up windows, or pop-up windows, not toll booths. Three pop-up window, one toll booth, two RSVP, two quandary. Five non-pop-up windows, three pop-up windows, eight code gates total. They're good and bad against Kate. If I can put them in against Kit, if I put them in front of non-code gates, they'll be basically canceling Kit's ability. If I put them in the back, or if I, you know, I mean, if I put it pretty much anywhere, they're going to get broken by, you know, Kit's many, many decoders, be they Gordian or Yogg or Yagasaurus or Torch. They are not going to, you know, slow the runner down at all. Other than, you know, being able to force him to get non-decoding breakers out. So because I know what he's playing, I ice up HQ right away. Install and sweep. So 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 credits. He hasn't done anything yet. He's going to run R&D. Good choice. Nothing doing. Install self-mod. It's a self-modifying code. Sorry for the glare on the cards. Usually my videos don't have glare, but I just bought this new lens. And the way to fight glare on cards is with a polarization filter, or polarizing filter. And because this new lens I bought, which is way better for video in general and better for videoing Netrunner games, but it's a larger, has a larger thread size for filters than my current lens. So he thought that was a Sansan. He was like, Rez, run, trash a Sansan. It was another pad campaign. So he does trash that pad campaign. He lets me keep the Rez one. Install draw 2. And see, that was a smart play, right? I drew, I think I had an ice, but I installed and drew 2 to try to find a better ice to put in R&D. So he's going to run that Jackson. I'm going to let him trash it. He's low on money right now. He's down to, right? I'd let him pay the 3 credits. Oh, I think that self-modifying code, yeah, is a, should be a magnum opus by now. He just never actually went and got the magnum opus. Yeah, remember the turn where he ran the pad campaign thinking it was Sansan? That turn, all he did was turn the self-modifying code into a magnum opus, take 6, and run that pad campaign, thinking it was a Sansan. It wasn't a Sansan, so he spent the 4. But he actually didn't physically go get the magnum opus. So now he's getting it. I'm setting up a little remote. And with that little remote, I use a Sansan to score a Beal. Go, little remote, go. The little remote that could. Right? I mean, at this early point in the game, he's only got money. He hasn't played an icebreaker of any kind. You know, I mean, a decoder will get him in anywhere, but, you know, it's like he doesn't have an icebreaker right now. Let's try to do something while we can. He's got a magnum opus, the ultimate weapon against me. It's very hard to make him broke, even if I hit with a closed accounts. Take 8, and he's back in the game. Look how much money he has. This NBN deck usually beats runners by making them ridiculously poor, but you can't make Magnum Opus ridiculously poor. And it's a shaper, so, right? Even though it's kit, it's still a shaper. Test running. A Gordian Blade, that'll get him in anywhere. It is a Gordian Blade. Shwing! And runs the remote. He just has to trash the Sansan that's rezzed. That's right, that's pretty much what it comes down to. And what do I have there? Is it even worth rezzing it? Is it even worth rezzing? Nope, not gonna rez it. Trashes my Sansan. Probably should have put an ash under that Sansan. I don't know. But I had to move quickly, right? Before he got a breaker. To score that Beal out. Right? New remote. Draw some cards. Come on, Jackson. Okay. Yeah, I think I didn't res because it's a quandary. But look, he test ran that Gordian Blade, which means it's on top of his deck, and he's got three credits. So he's got to draw, take two, and install to get it back, right? And when he does that, he'll be at one credit, which is enough to break. I think it's a quandary on the remote. But it's not enough to trash anything in the remote. So this is yet another very tiny window I have to do anything with that quandary, pretty much. So he takes two. Run R&D. Oh, I think he's running R&D. Maybe because then I won't have money to use the Sansan or do anything with the card in the remote, right? Or res the ice on the remote. But yeah, see, now I'll res the quandary to keep him out completely. So he took two, ran R&D, ran the remote. So the quandary did do something. It was good that I didn't res it on the turn earlier when he could have broken it easily. If only that card behind the quandary was an AstroScript. If only. It's a pad campaign. But yeah, he would have easily trashed that pad campaign had I not protected it. So now that he's recognized that remote with the pad campaign is worthless, we're going to stop using it. We're going to set up a new one that might actually do something. Might actually have some defense. Okay. Take two, draw, install Gordian Blade, and run and trash my pad campaign. Yep. Whew. Notice, you know, in the other games, people let me keep my pad campaigns. And that is really, really bad for them. Way bad. I mean, trashing the pad campaign for four is bad, but letting me keep it is even worse. I try not to let Corpse keep any economic assets as much as possible. Even, you know, Eve, Adonis, Pad, Marked Accounts, you have to trash him. Alright, he's got a Gordian Blade, he's got a Magnum Opus, but he's got no credits because he just trashed a Pad campaign. And Magnum Opus, he will have to spend clicks to get credits. So he's got two. He's got four. Is my remote going to hold up with my three credits that I have? It's going to go six. And eight. Take eight. Take an eight. If that was an AstroScript in that server, I'd be able to score it. But it's not. Drawing cards like crazy, please. I had these scoring windows here. So draw two, take two. You know, all right, he's going to run Jackson because I've been drawing a lot. He doesn't want to let me do that. I'm going to use this Jackson. I'm going to take back a Jackson, obviously. A Sansan, a good choice. And I take a pad campaign back after some deliberating. I should have taken a hedge fund back, right? In this situation, I'm actually poor, right? And I need money to be able to use Sansan to res my ice. And a hedge fund or even a sweep sweep would have helped me with that. But a hedge fund's better than a sweep sweep. But I take a pad campaign because it's more fun. But yeah, against a Magnum Opus, a pad campaign doesn't help, especially when he's already shown that he's going to trash them no matter what. And I don't really have a safe place to put the pad campaign. I don't have any extra ice that I can afford to protect the pad campaign with, right? And if I do put ice in front of a pad campaign to protect it, you know, it's not actually going to, you know, work out economically. The money I spent rezzing the ice would never be paid back within the time frame of this game. There aren't enough turns left. So should have taken a hedge fund, but Pad Campaign's a more fun card. But yeah, taxing him at this point is pointless. He's already got 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14 credits. Okay. So I'm getting some money now. I put yet another card in my remote. And take credit. And did I do something else? I don't know. I wasn't paying enough attention. I'm not paying enough attention now to the game that I'm watching. Okay, he takes two with his Magnum Opus and Vamp. Oof, and I've only got one ice, so that Vamp is going to hit, but it's a Tollbooth. That Tollbooth's been sitting the whole game waiting for this, because I know he's playing Vamp. Think about Kit with a Gordian Blade can get through pretty much anything. With a Magnum Opus, he's got all the money. He's going to outmoney your corp eventually. He Vamps you, and then he runs the remote. And when he runs the remote, you can't res anything. Well, I can res a Quandary. Oh, I messed up here. I thought that was an ice wall, and I accidentally revealed it, and it wasn't an ice wall. So now he's going to access. Yep, there's the breaking news. He trashes my Sansan, and he trashes my Ash. I was so sure that was an ice wall. If he had decided to break the toll booth and then vamp my final two credits, I was going to use those two credits before he could vamp them to res the Ash to at least make it more painful for him if he did run the remote and I couldn't res the ice. Because he didn't vamp the two credits, I thought I would keep them and res Quandary Ice Wall. But I forgot that wasn't an ice wall. I should have just not res the Quandary. Then I would have been able to res Ash and at least taxed him a little bit more using the NBN recurring trace credit. So it was a slight misplay by me against the vamp, but the Tollbooth is going to help out here. And there's an AstroScript in my hand. If only I had a way to score that. Right? Look, that vamp shut down my whole, right? If he didn't vamp right there, right? We'd be walking our way to Astro City right now. All right, gonna install my useless remote, because at least I'll get a little bit of use out of that Quandary, make him spend one credit to take a look at the card that's in there. That's more than nothing. All right, if I paid for one for it once, I'll make him pay one for it more than once. He didn't actually run archives, he's just checking them out, because they're all face up. He runs, he breaks. There's a Jackson that I use. I'm going to get back Ash, Sansan, Hedge Fund. That's a good choice right there. That's exactly what I should have brought back. Give up on Pad Campaign. Give up on it. One Jackson remains. So even though I'm in a tight spot here, HQ is well defended by a Tollbooth. R&D is well defended by an Eli that will cost him 1 to 4 credits to break every time. So it's like three. He could spend 75% of every turn taking 4 and running R&D. Take 4, run R&D. Take 4, run R&D. So in 3 turns, he can run it 4 times. He can 3 turns, he can run R&D 4 times if he wants to break even with his Magnum Opus and whatever. So that's pretty good. That's strong enough. But my remote situation now is very bad, right? That's a Rota Turret, not an Ice Wall. I can't keep him out, really. Unless I need enough money to do my thing in the remote. and also res the roto turret. But there's a femme in the workshop. See that? And he's got enough money to get the femme out of the workshop. So, yeah. So let's try to make this remote secure. I'll load it up with ice. Then I'll take some money, and hopefully it'll be good enough. Kept the roto turret in the back, even though it's too expensive to res, and the femme is already there. I probably should have just thrown it out. Saved myself 2 credits. I think that was a mistake, right? Or I could have even just made a new remote. But yeah, if you think about it, right, the femme, right, basically breaks all the sentries, obviously, right? When you have a magnum opus, you can afford to pay for the femme, even though it's inefficient to break sentries. Then, on top of that, you're femming an ice with the token. And then, you know, the first ice on the server is going to be taken care of by Gordian Blade, no matter what it is, on that one run per turn. So, in order to prevent a vamp, you've got to have, like, you know, an ice, a meaningless ice, then an ice that's going to be femmed, and then another ice that's not a sentry and not a code gate. You know, so you have to have a barrier. and you have to hope he doesn't femme the barrier. If he femmes the barrier, well, you need another barrier. So you need, in order to stop him, to actually keep him out of a server, zero accesses at all, right? It's like a remote that you need to keep him out of for a turn. And remember, he has magnum opus money, so he can get in. You need to have something like pop-up window, ice wall, and only one of the ice walls got femmed. And it's not like he doesn't have a barrier breaker. There's a snowball. So, you know, if he wants one successful run on a particular server, he's going to have that one successful run if he wants it. And, you know, Vamp is a great card for that one successful run because you have no money, right? So, look, in this situation, if I get Vamped through the toll booth and then he runs the remote, I don't have a there's no way I can res, you know, all those ice I installed in the remote. It's possible that I could never res them if he just Vamps before running the remote every time. I'll have no money when he runs the remote. If I have no money when he runs the remote, I can't res those ice. So it's like I have no remote. And if I have no AstroScript and I can't keep a Sansan on the table, I mean, I need NBN, people, you know, it's without this biotic labor nonsense, you need to have a secure remote at least once in the game, right? You know, to get the ball rolling. And usually I succeed at that by making the runner crazy poor and not having enough money and also doing it early before they have. Because I'm way faster than they are. But against a magnum opus, it just can't happen. So he's going to let me res my ice. There's an RSVP in front. Good. Code gate in the front. Nice tax. Custom 4. He keeps going. There's an ice wall. So now the question here, right, is he could bring out the snowball to break the ice. But he knows the next one's roto turret. I guess maybe he forgot that it's roto turret. I don't know. Maybe he didn't see. But I only have 3 credits and can't res the roto turret. But yeah, yeah, I can't res. It's a Sansan. He trashes. The Sansan might as well just say on it, make the runner spend 5 credits. Yeah, even if whether he knew it was roto turret or not, the femme is still the play to go with, because if the third one's a barrier, it's not a big deal, end the run. If the third one is a sentry, right, then that is a big deal. He would suffer some consequence, right? Like if it was a caduceus or something. So, No, he's running again, but now I actually can res the roto turret, but I'm not going to. So he takes my Gila hands, right? I was hoping by just constantly installing into the remote, which is pretty taxing, cost him 5 credits, making him run there constantly, that I could make him poor, but he's got a magnum opus, so it's like run, spend 5, take 6. He actually made a profit on that turn. But I'm getting some money now. I'm getting some money, and the score is only 2-2, despite me being in a really tight spot. He doesn't have the money to the memory to bring the snowball onto the table right now. It's ticking down. Diesel. See, he's drawn, looking for memory. He needs memory. Or he needs to put something in the workshop to keep the snowball from just disappearing. Yeah, he doesn't need that against me. Feedback filter, I think, is as good as Deus Ex against Jinteki if you have a Magnum Opus. Right? If you have a Magnum Opus, all you need is that feedback filter. And you will using it to prevent a net damage. Okay, so there he goes. Is that a quality time? He's looking for memory. I'm looking for money. And any way to defend my remote. There's his memory, toolbox in the workshop. The other reason he always has to run every remote, no matter what, is because, if I have breaking news, I could attack his workshop, right? If I had been able to attack his workshop before that toolbox was out there, right? It's like, sure, he could have rescued the snowball, but it's where he has to uninstall something for that, right? So now that he has a toolbox in there and he has a zillion credits, I go advance on the breaking news. Right, and then he would have an opportunity, in between the scoring of the breaking news and me saying trash workshop, to rescue everything from the workshop. And he definitely has enough credits to do so. He's given up on indexing. Guess Eli is just too much, too inefficient for him to run it multiple times in one turn. Especially when my remote is very vulnerable to his weaponry. Yeah. And I don't have an AstroScript and I can't get a Sansan out. He can just block up the whole game just on the remote. Doesn't need to go to R&D. Okay, so he's bringing out the workshop. And is he also going to bring out the snowball? I guess he won't unless he has to. Oh, modded nerve agent. Scavenge the Femme over to the toll booth. Oh boy, right? Because I've basically been sitting here waiting for a secure remote that I don't have this whole time. So that can only mean agendas are piling up in HQ. And there are agendas in HQ. So a nerve agent, woo! Luckily, he didn't hit any, even with his nerve agent. So that one time. All right, let's block up HQ a little bit, Mr. Mr. Nerve Agent. Gonna put some defense there. See, I'm having money trouble this game, right? I wasn't, You know, I need more monies to be able to res these ice. Like, you know, I saw you. I couldn't res the Roto turret. I couldn't res Sand Sands and such. So I was holding on to the pop-up windows to wait and see for a server that he might run frequently. So now with this Nerve Agent, I know he's going to run HQ a lot, right? So I'll drop those pop-up windows there. He's going to see a bunch of cards. Oh, he gets scores 1. Scores 3-2. Nope. The Astro somehow luckily stays in my hand. Somehow. And hopefully the pop-up windows will dissuade him from going crazy with that Nerve Agent, right? I held on to them and I waited until to figure out the best place to put them. You got to put the pop-up window on the server. They're going to run a lot. See, they cost me. They didn't cost me that much. I paid 1, 2, 3 to install. I got 2 of those 3 back already. All right, now he's going for the remote. All right, Caduceus. So he uses a Gordian Blade. All right, 3 credits to break that. RSVP, break. That is no longer femmed. Right, the femme has been moved to the toll booth, but he uses 1 with his snowball. Oh, did he forget to use his toolbox credits, maybe? Or maybe not, I don't know. I'm not going to res my Roto turret because I only have 3, but I am going to res Ash, and I make it trace 6. He trashes Ash and does not beat the trace. And I push out a Beal. All right, 4 points. See, I did the math, and I saw, look, he has 6 credits there. Right? He could have, if, you know, beaten Ash's trace. Oh, he's going to play indexing right now. There's another pop-up window. Good. Money. Has he breaking Eli? He's double-clicking Eli for the indexing. Okay. That means he only has, if he sees more than 1 agenda, he's only got 1 more run to go and get it. And he can't double-click the Eli on this run. He's have to use his snow. Oh, maybe that's it. Is that if he paid with credits to break the Eli with his snowball on the indexing run, he would not have enough credits or clicks? Maybe. Yeah, I don't know. I probably would have saved the click to break for the after indexing run. You might have been able to squeeze out 2 post-indexing runs if you took 2 on a Magnum Opus or something on one of those remaining clicks or something. Maybe. All right, yeah, he has to pay to break it because he doesn't have clicks left. And Astro, so it's now 5-4. Right, so as I was saying, when I was in the remote before with that Beal, I did the math and I knew that versus Ash, he could easily beat the Ash Trace and take an Astro, which is why I put a Beal in there. Right. If I had known he was going to just trash Ash and leave the other card alone, I would have put an Astro in there. But now that he indexed and it's 5-4 and he only has 1 credit, I am going to install my Astro in that remote because I think it's too expensive for him to get in there. Even with his toolbox, right? If he takes 6 and run, that's 6, 7, 8, 9. Let's see, 1, 2, 3. The Gordian Blade keeps strength. 4, 5, 6 credits to get in. And I can't res a Roto turret right now. So, yeah, he could get in there if he wanted to. But he'd basically have to take a bunch of money and run there. And that would have to be his whole turn. Right? I've only got 3 credits. I'm keeping all of them to score the Astro if he lets me. He takes eight because it's too taxing to run there. And I score my Astro. Okay. Throwing some cards out. think I have an NAPD in hand, maybe. I can't see it. But yeah. Maybe that's why he chose not to run, thinking it would be an NAPD, right? Which, if it was, well, it wasn't advanced. So yeah, I guess if he would have taken a bunch of money and ran it that turn as a pad campaign, he's not trashing. There's a closed accounts. There's an NAPD. He pays for it. Game over. Game over. I lose. I had the Astro, you know, considering how much pressure I was under, right? With, you know, and some of the plays that happened there. The fact that I scored 6 was a miracle, in some sense, right? You know, that just shows you, right, how dangerous this deck is. That, you know, even, you know, against perhaps its worst enemy, right, Magnum Opus, right, against a deck that's just trying to tax all your money away. Because most runners, they get their money from transactions and resources, right? You play Sure Gamble, that Sure Gamble is gone. It's not coming back. Kati Jones, you empty her, right? It takes a long time to fill her up and empty her again. Or she gets trashed by breaking news or something, because it's NBN. So most runners who don't use Magnum Opus, right, once I kill their economy with closed accounts or making them do really expensive runs or making them pay to trash Sandson or making them pay to trash Pad Campaign, they're broke and they can't come back from that. And that gives me a huge 2 to 3 turns where they're just having to get their money back and I can score because they can't get in no matter what programs they have because they don't have any money. But against Magnum Opus, it's like they take 8. One turn, they're back in the game, right? And I just, that's not something that I can compete against. But even against that, even against the worst enemy, the Magnum Opus, and the Gordian Blade cutting down on my code gates and the kit ability, I'm able to score 6 somehow, right? That is pretty dangerous. But yeah, kit vamp is a thing. You cannot keep her out of HQ if she wants to get in. She play vamp. You lose all your money because it's Magnum Opus. You're not going to have more money than that. Then they'll run the remote, and you will not be able to res ice on the remote unless you have like an Amazon Industrial Zone or a Bioroid Efficiency or Oversight AI, because they never run the remote when you have money unless you really force them to, right, with a really aggressive corp. And you'll never res your ice on your remote, and you won't be able to score anything out of the remote. So you better be doing 100% pure out-of-hand scoring. But, oh, wait, your HQ is crazy vulnerable, and there's a nerve agent. So if you're holding on to agendas waiting to score them, you're not going to hold on to them that long. Oh, and there's indexing for your R&D, too. So don't try anything there, either. Yeah, it's really hard to beat that deck. It's not unbeatable, but it's strong. And no one plays it, because it's not easy to play. Right? You have to practice with that thing a lot. You know, I think most people would, if they net deck that list, would just say, what the hell is this thing? It sucks. Because they don't know what they're doing.